जी सलाम। सलाम। थैंक यू वेरी मच एवरीबॉडी फॉर जॉइनिंग दिस वेबिनार। डिलाइटेड टू हैव विद अस द एस्टीम्ड मैनेजमेंट्स ऑफ अवेंसियन एंड ऑक्टोपस डिजिटल। Today's speakers are Mr. Bakhtiar Hamid Wain, Founder, Director, and CEO of Avencian and Octopus Digital; Mr. Tanveer Karamat, Executive Director and President, Avencian and Octopus Digital; Mr. Saidullah Khan Niazi, Chief Financial Officer, Avencian and Octopus Digital; and Ehsan Khalil, Company Secretary, Avencian and Octopus Digital. I just wanted to highlight the process of questions. We do not allow live questions in webinars and request all participants to post their questions in the chat window along with their full names and name of their organization. We will endeavor to answer all questions in this session. Also, we will be sending the presentation to all participants immediately after the webinar. With that, I'd like to hand over to the mic to Bakhtiar Saab. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Saad. So it's a pleasure being here, and I miss the time that I spend outside, during the time when we don't do any investor brief, because most of the ideas and the way you guys challenge us helps us a lot in making our business plan. So we thought it's a good idea to meet the August group before our year ends. So the objective would be to give you a rundown on what we shared early vis-a-vis what our plans are and what are the future plans now, because we've achieved success in the last 3 years. We've achieved all our targets, but now we realize that we are very well positioned to take it to the next level. So I'll give you an idea of a high level plan on Avencian, give you an idea where we are on our projections, the way we shared it last time, and then also why do we think our future plans, what are the main elements of taking us to the next level. So questions would be welcome. I would love to have an open session. It's because of all these COVID and all that we've not done it in person. Inshallah, whenever next there's an opportunity, I'll like to do that so that we have a much more free-flowing conversation and discussion. Moving forward. So, just a sec, I have to see that it's not. Yes. So what is our brief history? So if you look at it, we plan our Highway 50 in 2018. The objective was that we would meet $50 million revenues or market cap, whatever comes first. And we achieved that. Then we developed a Mission 2020. Which was an accelerated business plan in which we said that, look, we've met all our targets, all our soft targets. So we have to now expand. We have to talk about how to expand in different geographies and business segments. And that Mission 2020 was achieved in 2020. And then we established our Octopus Digital. So based on that, we have now developed a plan which would go through 2022 and achieve $100 million in 2024. This is the new business plan that I'll talk about. And this is a business plan where we would be investing in terms of our capital, human resource, and every effort that we do in the coming years. So, what's the plan? 2021, we had said $51 million, we would pretty much achieve that $51 million. 2022, we're planning 65, 2023, 85, and 2024, 100 million. The whole team is working towards making a very detailed plan, a very granular plan that how we would achieve that. I'll give you some elements of that, but when we come next year in our investor brief, a very detailed plan would be presented. But the high level stuff that how and what are the areas where we will expand to achieve that, I'll give it to you in a minute.
Yeah, so yes, sir. One may add. These are the revenue recognition number. PO generation is much more than this.
We will talk about it. So how we want to do that? We want to expand our Pakistani business. We have a different ideas. We have developed our proof of concepts in different markets, different verticals, different areas. We are very confident that we'll take it to $20 million till 2024. Qatar and Saudi region, we've been working for the last 5 years in a manner to develop that business. We have a very profitable business, both in Qatar and Saudi Arabia. Now we are setting up joint ventures, taking the Saudi business to a different level, and we are very confident we will take it to $40 million in years to come on the full year 2024. Same goes for UAE. UAE had seen a little bit of dip in the past 3 years, but we've reorganized the things. Oil has bounced back. We've gone into alternate markets. Our numbers this year are very good. And then UAE is expanding into North Africa. We've set up a very exciting joint venture in Egypt. And we've also set up a very exciting joint venture in Nigeria. So all these two markets kicking in, 2021 and 2022 would be where we will set it up. We will move to a reasonable level and then scale it up in the next 2 years to take it to $40 million. And so the engine of growth would be going into new markets that we've already tested. The good thing is we've gotten business from Nigeria. We've gotten business from Egypt this year. We have settled our business in Saudi Arabia, and we have some outstanding partnerships going. So putting all that together and making a business plan, we are confident that we'll achieve this growth and take it to the level that we are presenting it here. Just a global footprint, it's another way to look at it. So how do we achieve that? So again, a summary of it. Geographical expansion. If you look at all my presentations 5 years back, we were only talking about it, that we would be doing proof of concepts in new markets. We will be setting up our structure in all of these countries. And we also explained that we do not work in a manner that we'll set up offices and take huge investment. We work on a methodology which calls international execution, which determines a very low fixed cost in the geography of operation, where only client facing and skeleton staff is available. But we do all our engineering from the back office. We do all our proposals. And that's a whole process that I've explained several times. So this process has been very successful, and we've added geographies. Now's the time to scale up. Proof of concept already done, business already done, and we scale it up. Expanding product verticals. We've we work in different verticals in different geographies. A whole plan has been established that how we will now, how the teams will gel together and work, pass on their expertise to different geographies. So we'll move into oil and gas in all the geographies, infrastructure, facilities, and fast-moving consumer goods, and water, and also food and beverage. So now we do have pockets of success in each geography, but the plan is to take those pockets of success and take it on to all the geographies. Then seamless solution delivery. A lot of work we've already done on it, but investment will go on to it on further refine our project execution topology. Then we are developing a very extensive HR factory concept in which we'll bring in trainee engineers, develop, nurture them, and make them ready to deploy in any geography that we want. So, explaining that, I'll come to the specific areas. Geographic expansion plan for Qatar and KSA. So I would say they are partnership, a very exciting thing that we'll announce in about 15, 20 days or a month is that we're setting up an equity joint venture with one of the largest groups in KSA. They have accepted our business plan. They believe that the way we do business is the way to do business. They have really appreciated our expertise, our technical skill, and what they offer us is a very huge footprint of their own industries and their footprint of offering services to different industries within KSA. We'll announce that. I can't take the name right now. It is under negotiation. It's almost there. So that makes us very confident that we will not be alone in that geography, but with an equity partnership with a very large group, very, very well-respected group of Saudi Arabia. So this is Qatar. We are already there and we are market leaders. All we have to do is expand it over to a few more verticals borrowing from other geographies. So Pakistan and other geographies would be working in Qatar with our Qatar team to add different verticals and different markets there with them. This is how we plan to develop Qatar and Saudi Arabia. So I also talked about UAE and Africa. So we, same concept, where JV has been established in Nigeria, and another, we have signed equity agreement with, again, one of the top five groups in Egypt. That company has a huge footprint. They're the largest EPC contractor, and we with them now are setting up a whole operation in Egypt. The way Egypt is growing, we believe that that would be our key market moving forward. And we also, we are very confident also about the fact that our partner is big, strong, and very well known in Egypt. We already got business this year. Next year would be our scale-up time in Egypt. So the business segments that I've talked about, detailed analysis of our the great team that we have. We have expertise in each of these business segments, but in different geographies. So an example would be that if you're very big in food and beverage in Pakistan, we may not have a presence of food and beverage in UAE. But now what we're going to do is we are developing a concept of subject matter expertise, which would then cut across all geographies and help our teams in every country. So this is the way we plan to do, say, food and beverage in UAE, in Saudi Arabia, in Qatar, and all these areas, Nigeria, Egypt, where food and beverage business is available. And same goes for oil and gas, power and energy, that we pick up expertise from where it is and then transport it to other areas or other countries that we're doing business. So again, we'll not limit to the product verticals that we already have. There is very detailed plan on how we would move to further improve our skill set into products, into product vertical, bearing the flag of being technology agnostic and using any technology that can be used in the world. So we would be doing that, and a whole plan is being developed. The high level plan is already there, but the team is working in a very detailed manner to add further product verticals in our organization. So what are we going to do about our engineering? We take pride on engineering. I've talked about it again, again, and again. I believe the way the team that we have, there is no company that can compete with us in terms of how we take care of our customers, how we implement, and how customer-centric our approach is while delivering our projects. But we can't just stay there. So what we're going to do is, we are working on an extensive program that how we will further expand our international execution. So we want 100% of our execution being done at a common pool, which would reduce our cost and which would also improve our quality, because the same people would be doing the same task again and again. We want to transport our complete engineering on the cloud. Once we do that, that makes us a very virtual organization. So the customers would have access even to the work which is in process. So we would be moving our engineering to the cloud. We would be working on digital twin technology and doing testing and execution, a component of it, also remotely through the cloud. So when we do all that automated testing, simulation on the cloud, that we believe will eliminate any rework, and that would position us in a very unique place compared to our competition. None of our competition has either the bandwidth or the investment or the deep pockets to invest on this. We will be investing on this, and this would be our flagship when we go to our customers in future to present our company. And this flows into the HR factory that nothing can happen if we do not have a top quality HR plan. We take pride in our HR plan, we take pride in our HR department, and our HR policies, including the stock option plan, has been cutting edge and probably been up there better than any organization in Pakistan. So we have to build on that and not just talk about the past. A whole plan has been developed, and we would be, like I said, from cradle, taking a young engineer and increasing the skill set to the highest level. That will be the job of our HR factory. So this is how our future looks like. All the specialty and all the expansion, all the new things that we are talking about will go around in every geography. Which is the real expansion plan? So where are we right now? We have a backlog again, a brilliant backlog of $45 million. You can go around, and it's very difficult for our competition to talk like that. Very well positioned at a purple patch, once again, with $45 million of backlog. Another thing that I would like to talk about is our revenue recognition policy. Although we talk about it, I have talked about it a lot during previous years, but somehow the question comes up again and again by somehow benchmarking us with other companies and all that. I just like to be very clear that we probably have the most conservative revenue recognition policy in the market. We follow FIRS 15, and that too in a very conservative manner. our revenue recognition policy is approved by the auditor, which is EY, and they look at every project, every revenue which comes in through that. So even if we recognize any revenue in terms of cost completion, it has to be revoked if that the revenue that we've recognized and not invoiced. If we don't invoice in a given period of time, that has to be revoked. And that would come in the balance sheet also, by the way, in all our accounts. So if you look at all our quarterly accounts, you would hardly find any revenue being revoked. And that's a testament. So that means any earning in excess of billing then goes through the cycle of invoicing and then goes through the cycle of receivables. So it is, I'm not saying that it is, the best in the world, but I tell you, so much effort goes into it that what you see is what you get is our accounting. If you have any questions, please write it on the chat because I would like to beat it till death. Whatever we report, we take pride in the fact that that reporting of revenue is top quality and bulletproof. I can't emphasize it more. So that goes about revenue recognition. So before I go further, because for the first time 6 months back, we gave a projection also. While we were doing the IPO of Octopus, we also wanted to give our projection so that, people, could benchmark us that, what we, so we wanted to say something ahead in the year that, look, this is our backlog. We kind of are 100% sure that this would be our revenue at the end of the year. So what I've done now is that I've benchmarked, I've asked our team to benchmark our projections, which you would see very soon when December 31st ends and we'll issue our account, that where are we? So if you look at it, it looks really good. We will meet our revenues that we had projected. We will meet our operating result and we will meet our profit after tax. So we are projecting that we will grow around 21% in our PAT and grow 32% in our revenue, which would be the highest ever in our history. So an important thing I wanted to point out here is that we had even projected that our profit after tax would not grow with the same percentage in terms of revenue because we are scaling up now. We can't keep the same margin moving forward when we're growing. But on absolute terms, our profit after tax would increase. So PAT growth, revenue growth, PBT growth, EBITDA growth, all is on the cards. And we stand by on the project. I have not taken anything. This is not new. This is what we presented. All I'm presenting is that we stand by our projection that we presented to all of you about 4 or 5 months back. So another thing I wanted to add was, because we're talking about a lot of investment, how would we do that? So I thought for the first time, I'll just present our, so this is how our liquidity looks like. So December, we would be 1.7 billion of liquidity. And then we're looking at increasing the liquidity in the next 3 months because whatever revenue that we've recognized, we have invoiced, now money would be coming in. So by March 31st, 2022, we're looking at about 2.5 billion rupees of liquidity at Avancian as a whole. So another view of what the projected revenues and profit looks like. This is nothing new. We had projected it. It was slightly, the number was probably 4-5% up or down, but The bottom line is that we stand by our projection because, you know, here another important thing to emphasize is that, you know, people forget a little bit of history. When they look at third quarter results, they start thinking that, oh my God, third quarter is like that. This is the nature of our business. We have explained it again and again that we do not interfere with the revenue recognition policy. We do not force our revenues to be equal. We are in the business of projects. And even if we have backlog, a lot of it is then recognized in the last quarter. So again, coming back to the point of revenue recognition, if you see the difference of revenue in each quarter, that's the nature of the beast. And we do not want to artificially do it on, and even it out in four quarters. That's why I'm presenting a history that this is a trend. This has always been like that. But what is important is that you see that we do not change the revenue recognition policy just to dress it up. This is a very key message that I want to pass on. We stand by our projections, and that is where we stand by. So this is again a slide from our IPO. I think this is the growth pattern that we predicted for Octopus. As I said, take it as year one, year two, and we stand by it. The excitement in our Octopus team is, has no bounds. They are out there in the market. The response is fantastic. And although it's just been 2 to 3 months since we did the IPO, but I'm just emphasizing it once more that we stand by our commitment and we will be at it. You guys know this better than we know. You can plot this also, but this is after putting in all the bonus shares and everything. This is how our stock growth is. Last month or month and a half has not been good with the stocks, but we've put that in also. This is what you get, and this is how. So it's interesting. Another point that I want to make is that, although I'm not at all a fan of devaluation, but market takes devaluation unkindly, and usually, whenever rupee falls, there's a fall in the market. But in all fairness, 70% of our revenues, even probably 75% of our revenues, are international revenues. We are growing our business internationally at a much faster pace because that was the business plan 10 years back. So for us, again, with a disclaimer that I'm not a fan of devaluation, but I never understand that how does devaluation affect our stock price, whereas our stock price should be complemented with devaluation, because that means you would have more revenue in terms of rupees. So this is just a topic that I wanted to touch. So pretty much I'm at the end of my presentation. The objective, as I said earlier, was just to give you confidence that whatever we said, we stand by it. Just to give you a flavor of where we would be when we come back in the next about 2 months for another investor brief, where we will be presenting a very detailed plan of taking this company to $100 million. And our team is gung-ho about it, extremely excited about it. And I, for one, am sure that like they have never disappointed the board or the investor, the new business plan, the accelerated business plan, whatever you may call it, what they are out there to do by 2024, I'm very confident that they'll achieve that, because we have the best team possible. So thank you so much. The floor would be open to questions, and I will wait for the moderator to pose the first one.
Thank you very much, Bakhtiar Saab, for a very in-depth presentation. And once again, it's a pleasure to host you and to learn about your company and your plans. There are quite a few questions. Alhamdulillah, we have very good participation, where our number of participants have crossed over 100. So one of the questions that I see in the chat box is regarding the textile sector. The question is that given the strong growth in the textile sector, what are your plans to penetrate that sector going forward? And this comes from Mr. Inam Ahmed. Sir, you're mute.
So this is a very good question, and I'm happy because our team has already, in the business plan, high-level business plan that I was expounding on, the team has already talked about it. And they've realized that our entry into this market is through Octopus. For the first time in our lives, we have live opportunities in our CRM, in our funnel of... So there are several top quality textile companies which we are actively pursuing now, which we were not doing a year back or 10 years back or ever. So we are dabbling in it, and this would make, I won't say substantial, but a reasonable amount of revenue in Octopus, hopefully for years to come.
The next couple of questions come from Nasheed Malik from Faisal Funds. The first question he has posted is, what is the approach to developing an IP dashboard industry-wise? Is it primarily client-driven or more the idea generation from generated from your end? And his second question is, what is the biggest challenge of expanding Octopus modules in North America?
Brilliant questions. I think that the first question, because IP development, IP dashboard development has to be a very thought out process, because techies like us and dreamers like us can go into a direction that that could be great technically, which could feed our technical egos, but would not be successful in terms of making it commercial success or commercially viable. So if I go back to our presentations during Octopus's roadshows, we had defined whatever IPs that we will develop in the next 3 years. Those IP dashboards come from our sales team, marketing team, and our experience of last 10 years in operating in different verticals. So we've identified, we've done a lot of thought has gone into it, that, and then a lot of client interviews have gone into it, that what are the areas which are the lowest hanging fruit, and that's what we'll be developing on a proactive basis for the next 2 years. So this is the answer to the question. It's not like a totally opportunistic manner. And then within that, we will get opportunities. So there will be some, like if we, we don't have experience of solar, but there are companies that we're working with who want us to develop something like that. And there, so if we get long-term partnerships, long-term partners in a specific vertical, we'll develop it for them also. But short answer, we have evaluated the market and we've developed a whole roadmap of doing that. The second question was, can you, Saad, tell me the second question again?
Yes. The plan to penetrate the North American market.
Yes. Now that is, look, again, in our IP roadshows, we believe that whatever, although the success would be substantial of doing it in Pakistan and Middle East, We believe the real market is North America, and going there, one has to be very, very well prepared. So yes, we had defined KPIs in our business plan that what we need to do before going into North America. So the biggest KPI was having X number of subscriptions in X number of verticals so that we can demonstrate there that we are operating in a widespread manner. Then developing a partnership and a team there. So having, and third is raising capital. And in our plan, all three were very well defined that when we will declare victory in terms of let's enter the market, when we will forge our partnerships, and when we will raise our capital. That's part of our IM and what we presented during that. And then if we want a separate conversation, Saad, we can have a separate conference, a discussion with the gentleman, maybe later on one-to-one basis.
Sure. Achha, I'm seeing some questions specifically regarding 4Q. Specifically one, person is saying ki itna revenue 4Q mein banega given the 9-month revenue. To us pe thoda sa agar aap re-emphasize kar sakein, Bakhtiar sahab ke 4Q mein.
I have explained. I think Saeed is smiling. I would say the main culprit and the main doorkeeper for all this is Saeed Niazi is very strict in that. And same are our auditors. We have signed off a revenue recognition policy with them. We can't go beyond that. Saeed sits with the project teams, takes commitment that look, even if you have a project of $10 million, how are you going to recognize it? And if we can't recognize it in the first quarter, he doesn't. What do I do? And project is going on. We are spending money. So second quarter, third, and when the milestone comes that yes, customer has accepted it, then he has. So all these revenues are not from thin air that we are projecting. These are things that already say the project is already delivered. So if you have a separate conversation with Saeedullah Niazi, he will come to such a granular position, and then he can raise his hand and say no if he disagrees with me, but he can honestly take you down to the last dollar of each project, that where is that dollar in every project and why he's saying that this will now be recognized in Q4. So it is not coming out of my head, or oh, come on, let's recognize this because we have to achieve 8.6 billion rupees. No, not at all. Every project comes out of ERP. He knows the cost. He's working with project teams. So he's not just a hands-off CFO. That we have to drive the teams to achieve that. And then at times, the whole thing is going, if you don't deliver it on before December 25th, if the airway bill is not there, I will not recognize it. It is to that granular level. So I'm telling you, it's not just out of thin air. If any of you, any of the analysts wants to have an idea on how we want to do it, have a separate session with Saeed Niazi. He will bore you so much with every dollar that you all of you will run away because he would have everything on his fingertips.
Niazi sahab, would you like to add some comments?
I think Bakhtiar sahab told earlier when he was explaining the revenue recognition slide, he told that this is the giant and this is the giant and we can't make up. We can't do any window dressing. And definitely, this is the business cycle and we are just following the cycle. And there's no involvement from our side. We are just revenue recognizing based on the IFRS 15 and the more conservative approach based on the obligation transfer. So, you know, our auditor is also a top class EY, and you can't expect anything the help from the auditor. Yeah, we have to follow strictly rule. Definitely, this is a market, our trend, the revenue recognition trend. And that's why we explain in our slides, quarter, third quarter revenues, and the fourth quarter. And definitely, we are not involved doing from our own side. This is the business.
On the lighter side, Saad, on the lighter side, you know, it's very interesting. If I look at my last 3 years, audit points has always been in terms of revenue. When I sit with the auditor, because they always want to have a meeting.
Want to explain, Bakhtiar Sahib, you know, last time the UAE auditor increased our revenues.
They increased our revenue.
Yes.
It is very interesting that they said, no, EY said, you are sandbagging your revenue for the next quarter. Because this has to be revenue, it has to be recognized. And as much as I wanted to delay that revenue because our numbers were already good. So he said, no, it was not substantial, but he said, you have to recognize, it was about $1 million of revenue. And he forced us. He said, otherwise I'll put a note. So we have to recognize. So it was the other way around, that usually the notes are minor, that, okay, this has to be, we did not recognize. So it is, for us, it is the other way around. We are very conservative in recognizing them. The day we can't, if we can't do it, I'll come to the, you know, if the results are bad, I'll be the first one to come to the investor that, look, this year has not been good. No worries. We'll make it up for the next 3 years. But we would not window dress. Let me be that clear. I think that answers the question.
Excellent. And also, as I said, we'll be sending the presentation to all participants, and you can extrapolate, or we are here to answer any further questions. So hopefully that addresses that now. One question ek samne hai ke, one of your automation partners, Rockwell, has appointed some other companies as well, like Descon, in the local market. Has that impacted your market share, or has that impacted
they have not. Anybody who has this information, please send me a proper information, because rumors, anybody saying it, anybody following a business because we are successful and hoping that they would be and giving, that is, I would not comment on that. Even if somebody else comes in, we have a different strength. But it has not happened. Let me be clear.
Okay. Well noted. Baki bhi hai. One sec.
There's a one that is Octopus on target for revenue and PAT. When we saying that we are on target, we will be on target this year. Let's worry about the future years.
Baki, again, there are some questions regarding the additional 5% right issue. So I'd like to state here that this webinar is specifically for the business fundamentals and the outlook of Avention and Octopus. And we are here to discuss separately regarding that transaction, the rationale for that transaction, separately, other than this webinar.
So there's a question about the share price, that share price is, I'll also, that it is 69 to 145. What we do is, when we present this slide, it is based on, you know, you factor in all the dividends and the bonus shares also over the year. So this is cumulative of that with all the bonus shares, because the price, starting price was 14 rupees, and as it grows with more bonus shares, it has to be factored in. So this is the other thing that Saad saying, yes, we will do a separate thing on that. And anybody who wants more information on the 5% that we are planning to has to contact BMA, and we'll be very forthcoming in giving all the information.
A good question. What are your thoughts? This is from Mr. Sarfaraz Ahmed. What are your thoughts on maintaining a healthy balance sheet over the long term as the company continues to grow? How much leverage is acceptable?
Look, we are. This is a very good question. We are very anti-leverage. If you look at our balance sheet right now, there is no leverage. And a lot of financial people tell me that, look, it's healthy to be a little leveraged and all that. But I believe that a tech company, a company like us, look, we've been performing very well for the last 5-7 years. So at times, that can be your enemy also, because you start taking leverage and you never think about a bad year that could come. Tech companies and company like us, it can be a disaster if we are leveraged and we have a bad year or two. So we'll continue to keep our balance sheet like that. A little bit of leverage long-term maybe in future. And that could be for a specific purpose. Like if you're raising capital and you want to bridge it with some leverage, that makes sense. But running this business at leverage, I am the biggest no vote on that. So that's why our leverage hopefully will remain the way we are running. Any other question?
One question. Are you facing competition from Schneider and Siemens in Pakistan? Or baki ek international companies jo hai in this space mein, any jo competitors hain, unpe aapke kya thoughts hain?
Again, what's a business which does not have competition? If you don't have competition, you die down, you don't improve, and especially in, you know, what the kind of work that we do. If we don't have competition, we'll not learn new things and we will die out. We have competition. We take it in stride. But even if you ask Schneider, which is like, we are like a tiny, probably 0.1% compared to Schneider. It's a Fortune 1 and Siemens. Ask them. The question should be asked to them that who's the market leader in Pakistan? And they'll say Avancian. So Siemens has decided to partner with us in all large projects. We will announce a very big project that we'll do with Siemens. Schneider, I mean, they have their own partners, but they have hardly put a dent in the market. And because of them, we are partners all over the world. And then they use us for their engineering. Same goes for Siemens. But in Pakistan, we are happy to say that we are market leaders. We compete with them, and we believe we have a better structure, a better investment, a much better team than them to deliver the projects.
Okay. This question comes from Usman Zafar regarding Octopus. What he's asking is the savings generated by a customer, by the predictive management services of Octopus, how much are those compared to the revenues that Octopus generates on providing those services?
It could be, they could have a payback of 1 day or 2 days or 4 months or 9 months. It depends on the type of process. If I understand the question correctly, a lot of people try to offer these services, in terms of payback. We have done that also 5 years back, and we were very successful. But that model is not scalable. The real model in that is that you develop a technology which assists the customer to improve their efficiencies, reduce their wastage, have a payback on that. So we don't guarantee any payback. We say, look, we will empower you. We will onboard you in certain things. And you have to utilize this tool because if we start benchmarking against, or if we start benchmarking even our pricing against the saving that they achieve, we will not then expand. We will just be focusing on the customers, which have a higher payback. So our business plan is expanding to every industry and giving them what we have and convincing them on the value proposition. They do talk about paybacks and they do talk about savings. And we say, my God, we'll assist you for that and keep the saving.
Okay. A good question coming from Taha bin Yamin, aur aapne presentation mein bhi bataya tha regarding Octopus. Any new customers that have you onboarded since the IPO? Any names?
We've done Pakistan Tobacco Company, which for us, whatever the size of the company, that takes us to a different level, and that is a great testament because their global IT team evaluated our everything down to the security and everything, and only then they allowed us to connect to their component in the factory. So that opens up everything for us, that we can say, look, if British American Tobacco's tech team from the UK evaluated our methodology in terms of security. So that there are a few others. Look, this will continue. So there are several companies who are evaluating us. I like to emphasize that Octopus is actually dramatically different from Avancian in terms of revenue, in terms of cycle, because here you are, and the problem of quarterly changing of revenues and all that would not be there. So once you onboard a customer, you can guarantee that the customer would come every month. So the real challenge there is reaching out to enough customers, bringing them through the funnel, onboarding them and taking it forward. So revenue would come once you have the customers. That's all. So there is the excitement is there. There's several companies internationally also shown that excitement. But as I said, there'll be ups and downs, but we are absolutely not concerned one bit about the product anymore. It is lovely. It is something that not many people are doing in the world, and it has a very unique value proposition.
Wonderful. Another good question, or is pe aap bada acche pe explain, or you are also sensitive about the topic regarding employee turnover. What's the employee turnover in Avancian?
Yeah, I wish I had a slide. Next time I'll bring a slide on employee turnover. We used to have it. Somehow in my presentation, it is not there. In our business, it is very high, but ours is way better than anybody. And then next time I'll present what is our turnover, in which areas, what cadre, because as our engineers go higher, they have to be. So the real movement is in the new ones, in our what we call baby engineers who come in, and as they learn more and more and they get attached to the company and we give stock options, so the turnover. So our turnover, a simple answer, is way, way better than any competition, but we'll present the statistics to you in the next meeting.
All right. So in the interest of time, I'll ask a couple of more questions from the chat box, and I'd like to assure participants that any questions that we have missed, we will separately address them in an email to you later. One question coming from Tahir from Pulse Securities is that, are you subject to any delays in equipments given the global supply shortages that are ongoing?
Yes. And that has kept Saeed Niazi and Tanveer Karamat up at night, and because of the revenue, absolutely. This has been a big challenge. And the other question I'm seeing on backlog, that also is a reason that a lot of projects, people are slightly not happy with the proposals, because what the delivery time is right now, So they are taking a little time in decisions. So yes, it is hitting business. Hopefully in the next two quarters, it will iron out. But yes, that has affected us like any other company in the world.
And also, Bhaktar sir, there's a problem in supply chain, international movement of cargoes also hurt it.
Same. Yes.
Okay. Last question and more of a macro question. Any developments you are witnessing from the government to facilitate IT sector boost exports? Any thoughts that you have given where you are and your business?
It seems that, we are a very government independent company. Whatever we've achieved is with zero help of the government, and I believe in a private enterprise.
Yes. I know there is no tax benefit for the technology companies right now.
So I think they've done some reasonable policies, but most of these policies are driven towards the fact that they want more and more tech companies or software companies to declare revenue through official channels. Because, if they talk about export is $3 billion, whereas through the state bank, it's $1 billion or it's $700 million. So all those benefits that are being passed on and the same are 100% of our revenue is reported and all that. So for us to get that benefit, there's no benefit. We're already doing it. So the drive by the government has been to bring all those companies within the, I won't use the word net, because it is more to do with the fact that they should facilitate them in terms of dollar remittance and all that. But in our case, we were doing the same.
Okay. Thank you once again, Bakhtiar Saab, Saeed Saab, Tanveer Saab, and Ehsan Saab for conducting this session. I'd like to thank the participants for joining this session and for giving an overwhelming response to this session. Once again, we'll be emailing this presentation to all of you and answering any unanswered questions that are on the chat box. Thank you once again. Thank you, Bakhtiar Saab, once again.
Thank you very much, everybody. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the lovely questions and participation. All the best, guys.
Have a great day.
सर नहीं हुआ
नहीं कुछ भी नहीं हुआ मैंने कमिटमेंट दे दिया है।